Well, good evening, everyone. My name is Jeff Todd, and I'm the Executive Director of Alumni UBC and the Associate Vice President for Alumni at the University. And it is indeed a real pleasure to welcome you to tonight's dialogue, Water Worries, What is the State of Our Most Valuable Resource? This is another great turnout this evening, and I want to thank everyone for carving out your time to join us at the start of this eighth season of our provocative dialogues presented by Scotiabank and our media and broadcast sponsor, CBC. As we begin the evening, we'd like to acknowledge that we're on the unceded Coast Salish territory. So I want to thank you again for being here and for your support of these important discussions in the community. And I especially want to just take a moment and say thank you to Scotiabank and CBC for their support. Will you please join me in thanking them? So this is an extraordinary time for UBC. Ranked among the top 40 universities in the world, in September of 2011, we kicked off the most ambitious fundraising alumni engagement campaign in Canadian university history called Start an Evolution. We had twin goals to raise $1.5 billion for student learning, research, and community engagement initiatives, such as this one in Vancouver and the Okanagan, and to involve 50,000 of our alumni in the life of the university by the fall of 2015, in fact, doubling our alumni engagement. So as of September, more than $1.4 million have been raised, and we met our goal of engaging 50,000 individual alumni with UBC last year. So thanks to you, our alumni, donors, and friends, we're really looking forward to hitting our new goal of 55,000 individual alumni engaged and our fundraising goal. So stay tuned. As a key legacy of the campaign, on September 30, just last week, we officially opened the doors to the Robert H. Lee Alumni Center, a home for alumni for life, right at the heart of the Vancouver campus. You saw a short video showcasing it before I walked onto the stage. Named after one of UBC's most dedicated alumni, Bob Lee, your new Alumni Center is the first of its kind in Canada, and it's a living symbol of the partnership between UBC and the alumni community. So we look forward to welcoming our more than 305,000 alumni to their home on campus, not all at once, obviously, but we hope you'll attend a future dialogue there or other activities to satisfy your intellectual, cultural, and social appetites and engage with other alumni, students, and faculty. Coincided with the official opening of the Robert H. Lee Alumni Center last week, we also launched UBC's Centennial Year. UBC's proud to mark its 100th anniversary as a global leader in education. 100 years since welcoming its first class of 379 students in September of 1915. To learn just a little more, I hope you'll direct your attention to the screen.
Earthly things more beautiful and splendid than a university.
There are few universities that can claim to have grown to the stature of UBC in such a short span of time.
It is the unique privilege of the University of British Columbia to be located where one of the world's most important traditions began and flowered.
At this significant milestone, we should acknowledge and praise those who founded the university.
You accepted traditions and became part of traditions.
Every last citizen is in fact a part owner. And this is without doubt what the founders had in mind when they chose for the university motto, Tuum Est, it is yours.
It is a place where those who hate ignorance may strive to know, where those who perceive truth may strive to make others see.
we may indeed be a people's university. That is the spirit on which this university was founded, and it still lives and survives on this great campus today.
Well, UBC's Centennial is a year-long program of initiatives marking 100 years of learning, research innovation, and community engagement. And over the past century, UBC is proud to have graduated more than 305,000 students who are making positive change in British Columbia, Canada, and around the world. A host of activities is planned, and I invite you to visit our Centennial website, ubc100.ca, for more details. So before we get started, I wanted to recognize and thank our esteemed panel for their time, and thank you again for attending and being here tonight. We're going to once again too be using our very cool audience engagement platform to engage everyone in the conversation. So if you'll actually, in this case, take your mobile devices out, it's permissible and we want you to do this, your smartphone, your tablets, your laptop. And what we'd like you to do is take 30 seconds right now to take out the device and go to alumniubc.cnf.io. And I believe the URL is actually projected on the screen. So this is going to allow you to actually ask questions and comment in real time throughout the discussion. Our other attendees can like your question. And when we get to the Q&A portion of the evening, we're going to endeavor to pose the top questions from the audience to the panel. So again, the URL is ubc.cnf.io. And we're going to also be sharing that on the slide deck throughout the discussion, so if you miss it this time. But just for a trial run, for those of you who've already been able to find your way there, you can answer the first question, which is, are you a UBC alumnus? Will you answer that now? And if you will, we'll start to see how many of you in the audience are actually alumni. So a little more than 50%, and for those of you who aren't, we're delighted to have you here. So thank you for joining us. So why UBC Dialogues? Well, our alumni actually have consistently told us that they want to hear from UBC in the communities where they live and on the issues that really matter to them. And our alumni also want to make a positive impact in their community and around the world. They also have told us want opportunities to connect with one another and with UBC. So this evening we'll hear from alumni, faculty members, and community experts who are leaders in their field. And their conversation is also going to be podcast on the Alumni UBC website, and videotaped conversation will be made available on the Irving K. Barber Digital Library as well. So on behalf of UBC and Alumni UBC, I want to welcome and thank our speakers again. And now it's really my pleasure to introduce Scotiabank's Tara Franken, who's the manager of personal banking for the Scotiabank Burrard branch, who will introduce our moderator this evening. Tara?
Thank you, Jeff, and good evening, everyone. I'm thrilled to be here tonight to welcome you all to UBC Dialogues. Scotiabank is once again proud to be partnering with our friends at UBC on this fantastic series of events. Like UBC Dialogues, Scotiabank believes that different ideas and points of view contribute to a strong and healthy society that fosters an inclusive culture celebrating talent and diversity. It contributes to a brighter future. Tonight, we're in for a real treat as we hear from an outstanding line of panelists. And it's now my pleasure to welcome our moderator for the evening. Johanna Wagstaffe is an on-camera meteorologist for CBC, covering local, national, and international weather and sign stories. She joined the CBC News Weather Center in the summer of 2007, working on the CBC News Network morning shows. She's now based here in Vancouver and can be seen on daily CBC News Vancouver and also part of a brand new CBC News Now team. With her background in seismology and earth science, Johanna is often utilized by CBC as the go-to expert for insight into breaking science stories. Some of the stories she's covered recently include the Copenhagen Climate Conference, the 2011 Japanese earthquake and tsunami, and flying with the snowbirds. Johanna graduated with an honors degree in geophysics from the University of Western Ontario. She was first exposed, no pun intended, to weather forecasting as a summer intern in the Environment Canada Severe Weather Centre, and then obtained her postgraduate meteorology certificate from York University. To guide us along in tonight's dialogue, please join me in a warm welcome for our moderator, Johanna Wagstaffe.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Tara. I'm happy to be connected to both UBC and CBC. And I'm very happy to be here this evening to moderate this important discussion. And I'm so happy to see so many of you out here tonight engaged in what may be one of the most important issues of our time. Obviously, as a meteorologist, water is pretty important to my job. In fact, it's the most important factor when it comes to the creation of weather. Kind of ironic that today, of all days, it rained the entire day, first time in 10 days, if you're wondering. And on top of that, we're tracking, believe it or not, a hurricane for Friday and Saturday for the west coast of BC. It'll be a post-tropical storm at that point, but pretty rare events. The extremes of this changing world, though, that I see on a day-to-day basis are just one aspect to this conversation we'll be having tonight. But it is something that I'm very passionate about. We often hear about the possibility of future water wars, as populations can't survive without adequate and safe supplies of fresh water. In fact, in part, one of the many factors in the current Syria conflict connected to drought. The effects of climate change are already leading to global redistribution of water reserves, and agriculture and industrial uses are further straining our supplies of clean, fresh water. We just have to look south to California in the midst of a devastating drought. And of course, in recent months, our own British Columbia experienced a drought that led to high levels of water restrictions that we haven't seen in decades, an extreme fire season, and the continued concern for landslides and flooding this fall with such a dry ground. So, the big questions. What steps do we need to take to the quality and quantity of our own water supply for decades to come? What lengths will our government go to in order to secure fresh water sources? And who owns the planet's water? And how can we continue to ensure there's enough to go around? We have four incredible speakers here tonight to address these very big questions. And really, the timing couldn't be better with so many of us experiencing firsthand a drought this summer. I would now like to welcome them on stage. I'll ask them to come up and take their seats, and then I'll introduce them. I wish I had more time to tell you about all of their amazing research and experience. As they take their seats in the chairs, that we will not be leaving these chairs. They take some effort to get into. So well done.
What I'm worried about is getting out of them.
So let me start by introducing Margaret Catley-Carlson. She's an international civil servant who is actively involved at the board level in support of improved water resource management and the twin issue of agricultural productivity and rural development. She is vice chair of the Canadian Water Network Board and patron and past chair of the Global Water Partnership. She's a member of the United Nations Secretary General's Advisory Board on Water and the Rosenberg Forum. In her earlier career, Maggie was president in the Canadian International Development Agency, deputy executive director of UNICEF in New York, president of the Population Council in New York, and deputy minister of the Department of Health and Welfare of Canada. She holds 10 honorary degrees and is an officer of the Order of Canada. Very pleased to have you here tonight. Next, I'd like to introduce you to Simon, is an associate professor and someone whose name I see all the time connected to meteorology on a day-to-day basis. He's an associate professor in the Department of Geography at UBC, as well as an associate in UBC's Lew Institute for Global Issues, Biodiversity Research Center, and Institute for Resources, Environment, and Sustainability, and the Atmospheric Science Program. Simon's research examines how changes in the climate over time affect biochemical cycling and the function of marine ecosystems like coral reefs. He spends much of his time educating the community about climate issues. Very nice to have you, and to meet you in person, finally. Next, I'd like to introduce you to Damien Gillis. He received his Bachelor of Arts from UBC in 2002 and is a Vancouver-based documentary filmmaker with a focus on environmental and social justice issues, especially related to water, energy, and saving Canada's wild salmon. He is co-founder of the online publication The Common Sense Canadian, which, as the website states, is an uncommonly sensible take on our economy and environment. He is a director and cinematographer, more recently known for his brand new film, Fractured Land, which is currently being played at the Vancouver and Calgary International Film Festivals. Nice to have you here. And finally, Leila Harris, an associate professor at UBC's Institute on Resources, Environment, and Sustainability, and Institute for Gender, Race, Sexuality, and Social Justice. She is co-director of UBC's program on water governance and is a member of EDGE's Research Collaborative, Environment and Development, Gender, Equality, and Sustainability. Leila's work examines social, cultural, and political economic dimensions of environmental and resource issues, especially in developing contexts. She has focused extensively on water politics and governance questions, including research on water access, affordability, and management in Turkey, Ghana, South Africa, and for First Nations here in British Columbia. Nice to have you here. So I'm just gonna take a seat here. And magically, a new microphone starts working.
Oh, la la. Ooh, it does too.
Yeah. So just a few comments before we continue. What an amazing panel here. And not to put any pressure on you guys, but we had a phone conference to start the discussion going a couple weeks ago, and I was just blown away by the depth and the breadth of the knowledge. So we had some great conversations, so no pressure, but I think no. You're in for a real treat. Just a few comments on how things will work about the format of the Dialogues event. I'll be asking our panelists a couple of questions for the next half an hour, and then I'll turn the floor over to you, the audience, and I'll both use our fancy technology, as well as I'll give you a chance to talk face to face. And of course, this evening we'll finish with a complimentary reception. And at that point, please feel free to continue the conversation individually with all of the panelists. And a reminder, we are recording this event, which is very cool. And you can check that out after the event on the Alumni UBC's digital library, www.alumni.ubc.ca/podcasts. Okay, let's get started. Now, Margaret, perhaps we can start with you with the big question. I'm gonna start really big here. What is your outlook on the current state of water management globally?
And I have 2.5 hours, right?
Yes, exactly.
Yeah. Thank you. Delighted to be here. That's all the time I've got to say that. My outlook is global, and I'm not a hydrologist, agronomist, geologist, an economist, an economist. You know, my privilege has been to work with folk who are, and to bring a policy and financing perspective to this, and to try and make the organizations better able to get themselves supported and to get the policies out there. So that's sort of what I do. I don't have the expertise that the other three, in the sense of the depth. I've got a lot of breadth. I used to say my knowledge is like the Rio Plata, very large, but in some places about 6 inches deep. So what I want to do in answering your first question is go global and then swoop in a little bit to BC and then go global again. All of this in 2 minutes, right? Things are bad, if you needed to find that out. We've got about 70 rivers around the world that no longer reach the sea as they used to. How many of you have stood in Cairo and looked at the Nile? Yeah, well, it doesn't go to the Mediterranean. If you go towards the Mediterranean, it simply disappears in irrigation ditches and completely disappears. The same is true for the Indus, for the Yellow River, for the Colorado, for a lot of very substantial rivers. The uptake and the use of our river resources and our lake resources is such that some of them are disappearing, and certainly the deltas are being absolutely affected, which has a huge effect on livelihoods, et cetera, et cetera. Freshwater fish are in a desperate state, something north of 60%. I'm going to leave this to Damien to talk about more. But groundwater, we've completely ignored. It's the water that we don't know about, and I think the best way I can tell you about what it was, I had a Punjabi taxi driver taking me to the airport, and he said, "What are you going to?" I said, "A water meet." He said, "Ah, when I was a kid, I was told don't dig too deep, you'll hit the water." He said, "When I was 21, it reached 30 meters deep," and he said, "It's now at 120, so I got on an airplane and I came here to drive a taxi." He says, "It makes more sense than chasing water when you're exhausting the groundwater." So groundwater is a very big issue around the world. Wastewater, 80% of our wastewater around the world is not treated. And so therefore that builds up huge sanitation, health issues, and all the rest of it. We're pretty good in British Columbia, but our small communities in the north aren't. And boil water advisories are one of the answers to that. Droughts, we saw the big O in Australia. Okanagan, well, you know, is always on the verge of a drought. And here we had British Columbia having to move into unthinkable restrictions. So things are bad. Things are really bad. We haven't moved from 2.5 billion to 7 billion with any degree of ease. There are good signs. We know a lot, and we know better. We've got books, conferences, workshops, really good research, networks. There's more knowledge spreading. The idea of what we should do is better known, and that's really important. We've got lots of expertise on new things, like how to finance water projects, how to engage communities in this, how to work across some of the boundaries and some of the borders. We've got people that have figured out how to make rice pretty flood-proof so that it can be flooded, and when the flood's gone, the rice will stand up again and grow, and how to make other grains pretty drought-proof. So that's really important. What we don't have is the system of governance and incentives that moves knowledge into practice. If you think of an Indian farmer who's got electricity free and water free, then what is his or her incentive to use a new crop that uses water differently because he or she can use all the water that they've ever wanted to use? So incentives are everything all over the world. You really have to look at what the incentive pattern is that's actually in play here. I thought you'd be stopping me by now. I wanted to get all that said. So, well, you know, my real message is that we've got terrific problems because, as I say, we've gone from, in my lifetime, 2.5 billion to 7 billion. That 7 billion is more prosperous than it used to be, therefore they want protein. We're using more water to feed them. This is the principal problem, but we've also got the current and looming problems associated with climate change, which are going to cause the kind of extreme events that'll keep you occupied and employed for a very long time. And the remedies, such as they are for these things, do not get a lot of uptake because of the problems with incentives and governance. And Leila's spent her life thinking about this, and I hope we can spend lots of time talking about those things, because that's the principal issue.
Well, that was a pretty good overview, and it is certainly dire. But I'm pleased that there were already some, you know, positive notes in there. Unfortunately, I'm going to come to you, Simon, on the equally dire topic of climate change. What is your perspective on the state of the world's water today in that context?
Well, I think thanks, Johanna. I think I can say some things that aren't necessarily that dire. And the first thing that, whenever thinking about climate change, most important thing to take into account is there's no such thing as a good or a bad climate. It's just about what you, the society, or ecosystems are adapted to, right? And so the issue that we're faced with today is that human activity through emitting greenhouse gases is changing the climate, and it's doing so faster than most of those systems can adapt, right? Because it's changing faster than we've seen in the history of human civilization the past 10,000 years. So that's the problem. What's it going to mean for water? Well, a warmer planet, basically supercharges the water cycle, right? So There's a whole bunch of ways in which this happens. The most basic one is that the warmer air is, the more water it can hold. You increase the temperature of air by about by a degree Celsius, and it can hold about 6-7% more water. And that means more intense rainfall, right, and all the things that can happen with that, flooding, landslides, etc. Now, that's not, you know, environmentalism or anything, that's just thermodynamics. It's really the first and second law of thermodynamics. It's an equation you can look up online. It's not too complicated. So one of the big concerns we think about with water is, you know, more intense rainfall, right? But on the same hand, and on the same side, and this is confusing sometimes, but places that are dry, we also expect to get drier, mm-hmm. right? And so the impacts of climate change on water is going to depend on where you are, but also is going to depend on when you are. And so for a place like British Columbia, one of our biggest concerns is timing. I mean, timing is everything in life, and it's definitely everything to do with water. So imagine a future in which the winters are warmer, so that, you know, it's still going to be wet here in Vancouver, but more of what falls in the mountains is going to fall as rain rather than snow, right? So that doesn't just affect the ski areas, it changes the timing. It means when the summer rolls around, right, the water levels in the rivers and the water levels in the soil have peaked earlier, right? So when the summer rolls around, we get what we saw this summer. You know, water restrictions in town, droughts affecting farmers, and then obviously forest fires and things like that. So that's just one example of the sort of ways that climate change can, you know, sort of affecting the water cycle. And really how dangerous this is for society, it's going to be up to us. It's really up to how well we can adapt. And so all these sort of trade-offs that exist that we're just hearing about in that sort of great global overview of water problems, trade-offs between industrial needs, societal needs, et cetera, those things could be exacerbated by the fact that the system and how much water is going to be available at different times is changing.
Well, yeah. I have a very hard time explaining climate change in my 2-minute weather briefings at the end of the show, so I'm going to maybe just copy that. That was good. Thank you. Damien, what do you think? Sort of looking through your lens, yeah. so to speak, on the what's your opinion on the state of today's water?
Well, I would like to direct my comments towards a few areas of particular interest for me that are predominantly local in British Columbia and in Canada. Based on my experiences, and it's a privilege to be in such esteemed company, I don't present myself as an expert, but as a filmmaker, I've spent a lot of time over the last 5 years, actually over the last 10 years in the north, particularly BC. I was heartened this year to see that as these drought conditions start to affect the cities down south, where we use all the resources but often aren't confronted with the consequences of that, that we were starting to recognize that we have a role to play and that we can cut back our personal consumption. And some of these things really started to hit close to home. But I think that we're too often dissociated from the big policy and economic decisions that our governments are making that largely affect the north. And there's two particular areas that I'm very concerned about. One is fracking or shale gas, which is more and more the way that we're getting gas. And some of you will have heard about the big LNG, liquefied natural gas plans. It was our kind of the big vision that was presented in the last election. And it remains a very important part of our province and our government's economic vision. What that would mean would be a vast ramping up of fracking, because almost all of the new gas coming online is from this much more water intensive and climate intensive, or greenhouse gas intensive process of getting these resources out of the ground. And in our peak years, when I first started making this film Fractured Land with my Vancouver co-director Fiona Rare, we were 5 years ago up north, and that was at the height of the boom. And we were over 10 billion liters of fresh water was being pulled out of the northern boreal, muskeg, lakes, rivers, and streams, contaminated with some very toxic chemicals, many of which we don't fully know or understand, and then blasted underground to crack open these formations. A lot of that comes back up to the surface and then is either put into tailing ponds to be treated or to be reused. Later, to cut down on water consumption. But that can have disastrous consequences when that leaks, and I've documented that. And then much of it is reinjected into the ground. And we don't understand the hydrodynamics underground of how this works. We don't understand our aquifers. We haven't done proper mapping. We have a scarce, for the 34,000 natural gas wells we have already in northern BC, we have a handful, maybe a couple of dozen test wells to monitor the effects on our groundwater. So we're really playing a see no evil, hear no evil approach to this. And if LNG goes forward, particularly if three or four of the 18 projects that have been proposed, we could see five times as much fracking up north. So we could be talking 50 billion liters a year of fresh water. That's not insignificant. The other big thing that's a real concern to me is we're planning to flood another stretch of the Peace Valley. My family lost its ranch in 1968 in that beautiful place, which has some of the best farmland in Canada. And so I understand what's there. And we only grow 40%+ of our food that we consume in BC. We depend on imports, particularly from California, which is in drought conditions today. So we're talking about flooding 30,000 acres of some of the best farmland that we have, or hopelessly perturbing it to the point where it can't be cultivated. At the very moment when our old model of essentially sloughing off those food needs on other jurisdictions to supply that to us is breaking down. And so we're making some very dangerous decisions right now around that. And finally, our regulatory regime, all the things that we would use, the independent monitoring of the Agricultural Land Commission, of the BC Utilities Commission, removed from that process. Our federal laws, like the Navigable Waters Protection Act, like many of our environmental rules, our environmental assessment processes, the Fisheries Act, Section 35, protecting habitat, all of these things, we've been in a rampant state of deregulation over the last 10 years. So at the very time when we need to understand these things, when we need to make science-based decisions, we're dismantling all that, and that's of great concern to me.
I can see how you've had the big industries on their toes.
That's what I do. It's my life.
Leila, we'll give you the last word on this for the moment. Drawing from your expertise on water governance and politics, what is your opinion on the state of the water?
Yeah, so one of the titles for tonight was Water Worries. And I just was thinking, what are the things that I actually worry about with respect to water? And one thing that people from my field often do is we actually often counter narratives of scarcity. So we often hear a lot these ideas that there's so limited availability of fresh water. But what we really try and drive at is actually that matters for certain people and not others. A lot of people have adequate access to water at a reasonable or no cost. And so it's really a question of the distribution. So similar to some of Simon's comments, it's often a question of timing and access when you need water, where you need it. So that's where the difficulties come in. We need water often for agriculture at the driest times of the year, you know, in the hotter times of the year. When we build dams for reservoirs for storage capacity, you know, that's not a process that we can just keep continuing to do. Most of our best dam sites have been taken globally. You know, so it's not something where we can just, as we need more water, we can just build more reservoirs. And we know, of course, there's many other consequences, including flooding of important agricultural First Nation indigenous areas, but also fish populations especially. So I think a lot of times we have these very global statements, but it really comes down to two things, I think, for me. One is the question of priorities and our decisions about how we choose to use water. And so something like, you know, drought, all of these things are real, but it's really how that articulates with our decision-making processes. Are we using water effectively, efficiently? Are we distributing it fairly? What are the prices that people are being asked to pay for water? And is that equitable in a range of considerations? So like Maggie, I also think about these issues globally. Increasingly, I've tried to think locally as well. And I just want to emphasize two points. One is what I've been referring to, that it's largely a question of governance and politics. So a number of people have said this. It's not just me. Maggie's already mentioned it. But governance refers to how we make decisions about water and its uses and its management in a day-to-day sense. What are our priorities about water? So even if you think about the global water crisis, which there certainly is one, you know, we have over a billion people who don't have adequate sanitation, many millions of people, hundreds of millions who don't have access to safe and affordable drinking water, over 10 million people a year are estimated to die from waterborne illness and preventable diseases. And I've seen estimates on how much it would cost to make drinking water available in those communities, and they actually are less than estimates of how much the U.S. spends on ice cream every year. So, you know, it's a question of priorities, and it's how we decide to go forward. We have the technology. We know how to treat water to potable standards. And the second large consideration that I just want to emphasize, and I think this will come out as we proceed in our conversation tonight, but equity is really, for me, a key consideration. So the state of our water, what is the state of our water, we were asked? It's a highly inequitable state. So someone in Canada or the US uses 5 times the per capita average for someone in a lesser developed context. Often a person in a lesser developed context where there's not the piped infrastructure that we enjoy often here might pay 10 times or even 100 times for the same liter or gallon of water that we do. So on a per unit basis, they'll pay many more times. And that could be someone living on less than a dollar a day. So in some of the areas where we've worked, for instance, some of the estimates in Accra and Ghana suggest that people might spend a quarter of their income just to access domestic drinking water and for basic uses. And that's a really worrisome and important state of affairs that I think, you know, in terms of the global institutions, many of which Maggie has great familiarity and experience, we could be doing a lot more. A lot of these statistics hold, even though we've already had major campaigns, decades for water for life, we've had the Millennium Development Goals, you know, we've tried many times to target this, and still we're not doing a very good job. I think some of these issues, again, that will come out, you know, the important point to be made too, this is not only a developing country issue, it's not only in other parts of the world. In Canada, the First Nations situation with respect to water on reserves shows how inequities bear out in this context as well.
Well, let's stay global for a moment, and I'll just put this out there. How does Canada's water management compare to the rest of the world? And I mean, I don't know how much we know as a group, but how does it compare even within the country?
Well, do you want me to start? I know you don't want to go up and down the rows like a panel, but...
You are a UN advisor.
Yeah.
Qualified to answer the question.
You know, basically, Canada doesn't get very good grades from people who study exactly that question. We're very fragmented. We've allowed ourselves to have about 23 federal government departments and almost as many provincial and then some municipal and band councils that can all make rules about water. There's no coordinating. We don't have mechanisms that coordinate the hydrology and the hydrological cycle with other use. We don't have mechanisms that look at allocation. We don't like our poor people any more than others like their poor people, which leads to what Leila's talking about, because you know, there's a lot of things in water that depend on very complicated stuff, but drinking water does not. It's not rocket science. It's a question of priorities and how much people plan, how much governments and communities decide to spend, and whether they decide to make that available to poor people. We're not bad about that, but we're not absolutely great. All you have to do is look at 400 boil water advisories in the north. All of the things that were just recited about things we used to be good at, understanding, setting standards, setting monitoring, setting baselines, all of those things that we used to be good at have simply disappeared. And plus we stopped funding the world's only lake institute. Thank goodness Ontario picked it up. But so, you know, we're not terrible, but I don't think that for the amount of water, now the two are very related because, you know, when I give speeches, I often start with this picture of global water and who's under water stress and who isn't. And there we are, all comfortable in the upper left-hand corner and bright blue and nowhere near water stress, which is always shown in oranges and yellows. Well, that gives Canadians the myth that there's really nothing, no problems to worry about. No problems about quality, wrong. No problems about quantity, wrong. No problems about the impact that climate change will have. I mean, for example, and you heard how the water in the winter is not going to turn to snow and ice. That means the glaciers are going to melt. So therefore, that part of the rivers that flow across from Alberta to Manitoba and Saskatchewan that came from the glaciers is going to be greatly attenuated. And so therefore, the agreements and the arrangements that allow that water to keep flowing across the prairies are definitely going to be affected. We've got algal blooms, we've got all sorts of quality issues. So, you know, I think we have the problem of being spoiled kids.
Yeah.
We've had so much water and of good quality, and so therefore People always think, well, this can't be as bad a problem as some of the other things, like getting covered with ice and snow.
Has anyone seen or have an example of countries that are doing it well, that are making it work?
They're all dry. Dry countries manage water well because they have to. Israel, Morocco, Australia, who else would we add? Germany's not bad.
I mean, the EU is often held as an example, but it would depend on what you're looking at.
Yes,
I think,
Germany's, monitoring. Germany's pretty good.
Do you think the recent drought here in BC changed the attitude of Vancouverites on this topic?
You'd have to ask them.
Yeah.
What do you guys think? How many of you have a different attitude towards your own water consumption in your community compared to before the summer?
Ah, that's pretty good.
Yeah, that is
that's
good.
Pretty significant.
Yeah. Sorry, I didn't have the fancy chart.
Yeah. We'll ask that later on the chart.
No, I was very proud of British Columbians. They actually accepted regulations. I was in L.A. twice this spring, and both times I saw people watering the sidewalks with drinking water. And, you know, so, and it took a long time to get regulations in the California context. So, you know.
Joanna, I wanted to go back to your question about how are we doing,
yes.
Just to cite one or two specific examples. And I do think it's important, you know, not to say it's all horrible, you know, but that said, I've been actually quite shocked since we've been doing some research on the drinking water quality guidelines and how they vary across the country. Mm-hmm. And there are only, in general, the Canadian drinking water quality guidelines, there are 94 different parameters, but there are only 16 that are common across the whole country.
Which is crazy.
And BC is the only state or province in North America that doesn't have regulated parameters beyond bacterial indicators. So we accept all the guidelines as voluntary guidelines, but there's no actual regulated parameters, which is highly unusual, especially in a developed context, in a more industrialized context. So I think we haven't seen necessarily a Walkerton. Most of us enjoy protected water sources when we're in the large municipal areas. So in a sense, it's not that bad, but the fact that we're very ad hoc and we don't have much in terms of regulation or requirements for testing and other things really puts us at risk in a way that I don't think people realize.
Yeah, sticking with sort of the idea of changing conditions, but moving to the idea that our climate is changing, what can the government do to prepare us? I mean, are we sort of beyond mitigation,
and
are
we just ourselves?
Yeah? Are we? What can the government do to prepare us for a changing future?
Well, I think one thing to keep in mind, you know, as obviously, we're all in this room familiar with the fact that the climate is changing, and it's changing because of human activity. And there are things that can be done to slow climate change. And obviously, it's quite controversial. The lack of action at the federal level in Canada has been a real issue. BC's been very progressive, but we should not
until the LNG just completely blown all our climate goals.
Well, if it's actually successful. So
we're prepared to, though, fully prepared to.
That's true.
That's right.
No, it's true. But this is actually a good point, though, is that though Canada and British Columbia can do a lot to mitigate climate change, there's no reason that you shouldn't also try to adapt at the same time. It's okay to try to adapt to the future even when you're trying to prevent it. And it's important because some climate change is baked into the system already, right? The climate's like a big super tanker. You know, if you hit the brakes, it doesn't stop instantly, right? And so we're sort of more like the Titanic really than the super tanker. We're sort of going towards the iceberg, right? And we know what it looks like and roughly when we're going to hit it and how hard we're going to hit it. And so we can plan on, you know, slowing it down. So what does that mean? It means putting in adaptation policies. And the city of Vancouver has been really thoughtful about this. Those water restrictions that happened this summer, a lot of that was about getting everyone in this room used to the idea. Because actually, Vancouver would have probably been fine water-wise without the restrictions, but it's a good way of getting society on board with the idea we might need to do this in the future.
And going forward in time then, I mean, the idea, this balance between energy and industry and energy resources and water. How are we going to balance that?
Energy always wins.
No, well, I mean, the whole of human civilization has been a quest for energy.
It depends what kind of energy.
That was a big question, yes.
Yeah.
It's a question of, it's if you look at some of the other, going back to the global level, on an energy level, we're really one of the only major industrial nations that isn't investing heavily in renewable energy today. And I'm talking about China. China's putting $70 billion of public money a year into kickstarting the clean tech sector. They've reaped 2 million new jobs in just the last 5 years in that area. America's number two in terms of gross volume. Germany, Brazil is a big player.
Korea is a big one.
Korea. So if you look around, we're doing almost nothing. You know, and this is one of the things I was kind of disappointed in the economic debate during the election. None of the three gentlemen up there really talked about that in terms of, okay, so if you're worried about the oil sands, if you're worried about climate change, then what do you propose as an alternative? How do you keep the Canadian economy going? I think we often harbor an enormous myth about just how important the energy sector is. Canadian economy is very important to Bay Street, to the stock market. It's actually pretty small in terms of provincial and federal revenues and jobs, like 125,000 direct jobs in this country in the oil and gas sector. It's not that big. The growth potential, given the inevitability of regulation, of carbon pricing, et cetera, as soon as we want to sell it to our neighbors, you know, we've been wrangling with Europe over the last couple of years, trying to keep them from imposing taxes. We can do that with a tremendous amount of money and lobbying pressure for a while, but over the trajectory is that this industry has much less growth potential than clean technologies do, which aren't necessarily in there. I mean, all forms of energy except for conservation carry consequences. It's not like wind farms and solar panels and geothermal are completely without problems. So conservation has to be, both in terms of energy and of water, has to be probably the biggest priority. And that's all about an attitude change. And so that, you know, whether it be on the personal level or on a policy level, and that's where we really need to go. But we don't necessarily need to depend on a fossil fuel sector that is, whether it be heavy oil or shale gas, that is very, very, very water intensive.
Which country do you think is the biggest user of solar at the household level, of solar panels?
Denmark.
Who said Germany? Sweden. You win. Yeah. And the incentive that we've been talking about, the incentives are everything. What the Germans did was something very simple. They said, if you make electricity on your roof and it's more than what you need, you can sell it to the grid. And so that makes the amortization of the panels extraordinarily more interesting. And they had the real wisdom to cut it out after, 10 years, 15 years? They actually cut it back again.
They had to because of energy poverty issues. So you get these sort of where the price of electricity became, you know, again, it's an equality issue where there's people on that scale who couldn't even afford it anymore. So you need a certain kind of balance.
But government policies work. I mean, incentives work. If somebody says to you, you put up a solar panel and we'll buy the energy that's left over, that really changes your view about whether the solar panel is a good investment or not.
Now, I'm going to just segue here because this is a nice time to start asking some of your questions. And I've noticed the top question is very much connected to the idea of government. A lot of you want to know the answer to this, but it is, we are literally weeks away from our federal election. So we are coming up to an election. Which parties do you feel care about protecting Canada's water supply? And that was one that a lot of you want to know the answers to.
I think the Green Party I'm not sure they're going to get elected.
I was heartened to hear Mr. Trudeau's promise yesterday, I believe it was, probably knowing that we were about to have this panel discussion, to end all
boil water alerts over the next 5 years in indigenous communities. Now, as Margaret pointed out earlier, if he's just planning to go and take the signs down, that's one thing. But no, hopefully the intention there is to increase our water, you know, quality equity in Canada. And it's nice to hear somebody talking about that federally. You know. The Green Party obviously has probably the strongest platform across the board. Go ahead.
Oh, no. I actually participated in a candidates debate a couple nights ago in North Vancouver, and it was on energy, environment, and the economy. So there were only three candidates there because the Conservative candidate did not come. Although they put his name on the chair, so everyone kept speaking to the chair. And there was one, all I can say is that basically the three parties agreed on almost everything, and they openly, the candidates said so, that this is going to be not much of a debate. We are going to differ on the details, right? So in choosing between, if you are interested in voting based on how the future government's, next government's going to manage Canada's water, the NDP, the Greens, and the Liberals, their policies and their overall big picture policies are not going to be very different. There will be differences in the details and the timing, who wants to do what first, how long they want to take to do it, but big picture, you know, they're over here, and then the conservatives are over here on most of these issues. And the most important thing to me would be just about regulation. So, for example, some new pipelines being decided on and everything. Let's put the regulations in place, is what a lot of Canadians think, such that the decisions being made properly, considering the impacts on water, considering the impacts on greenhouse gas emissions, and all these sort of things. And we've made all these changes to our laws that make environmental assessment more of a rubber stamp right now. But all three parties basically suggested the same changes. So.
But there's a difference in the timing, in the sense that the Liberals are talking about spending money, and they have consistently mentioned water treatment, and transmission. So first time I've heard water mentioned in an election for a long time. So they have said that they're going to focus on this, but I think it's within a policy framework, which isn't that different one to the other.
That was very well unbiasedly done. The next question from you, great questions, by the way. Thank you so much for submitting so many. I'm frantically iPhoning these. These are great. The second one really connects to the last question. What do you think about BC's new Water Sustainability Act, and what are some big things that you would like to see?
Leila?
There's been some really thoughtful efforts that have gone into describing what needs to happen. I'll back up and say one of the important things to recognize in terms of how that law came to be was the process, and there's been a lot of difficulties with the process and a lot of unhappiness, particularly with respect to First Nations. So all of the major First Nation groups have basically articulated very clearly and strongly that it wasn't proper consultation, and particularly having been considered stakeholders in the proper process, was inappropriate and didn't recognize First Nations rights and title with respect to water. So from the outset, even though there's lots, I think, to celebrate with respect to the new act and bringing on board and bringing up to date a number of things that we haven't enjoyed over the past century of the previous water laws, I think we have to give due recognition to that fact from the outset, and that, you know, it's inherently problematic in the way that we've come to that as the documentation and the act that we have. That said, you know, there's a lot of openings in the act to do water governance differently in the province. Groundwater is an important part, but what that really means and how it looks and how that will be carried through is yet to be determined. But there's a lot of interesting things that are mentioned. A lot of the NGOs and other groups are calling for actually regulations that will tie some of those things down. So rather than broad statement of principles, sustainability, for instance, let's define what we mean by that and actually tie regulations to it. So not just say in principle we want to ensure sustainable groundwater, but, you know, giving some specificity to that and teeth to that. So that's the stage where we'll be for the next period of time.
No, I give them credit for the groundwater, putting groundwater front and center, because when you've got a province that's full of rivers and lakes, to put groundwater in the first place, I think shows quite a bit of vision. They're going to have to follow it up with some research. I mean, groundwater is about aquifers, it's about what's under the surface. How big is it? How deep is it? What's the quality of it? Has anybody ever measured the quality of it? Does this aquifer actually drain? Does it refill when it rains? Some do, some don't. I sit on the board of one in Nebraska where the farmers themselves know how much the rain has that they have received has had an impact on aquifer levels, and they decide how much they're going to take out with their irrigation projects. So, but every aquifer is different. And if you take out if you take out of the groundwater here, what's going to be the downstream effect? Does the aquifer move? Does water move out of it? All these things are not particularly well known in almost all places because it's been out of sight and out of mind in a world that thought it had enough water with what they could see. And by the way, we'll just stick a hole and dig a well when we run out of the stuff that we can see. So now it's time to figure out what digging the hole and the well, what's actually down there. And that's going to take a lot of research, a lot of comparison. It's something that BC can get very good at. There's a lot of places in the world that are struggling to get good at it in a hurry, so we won't be alone. But it is something where, and I'm really glad they put it first, because I think the attitude to groundwater has been, I don't like Nestle bottling our groundwater. And you say, well, is that because they're taking too much? Well, I don't know. Well, is that because we're charging too little? Well, I don't know. Do we charge for groundwater? I mean, these are the kind of questions that we really need to have a much better handle on and have a much better public appreciation of. Maybe it's a good thing Nestle is using the water. Is it any different from the beer? The breweries taking water and putting it in bottles in a more interesting form. These things we need some public debate on.
Now I'm going to just pause again. Great questions coming in on the online questionnaire. But
can I just really quickly, Johanna, on that subject?
Yes, please.
I was disappointed with regards to the energy sector. There were some improvements in the new act, but it didn't think it went far enough. So I just wanted to insert that in there. We've got a long way to go. There's a tiny bit of improvement there, but anyway, sorry.
Good. I'm glad to hear that.
Yeah.
There'll be, and this is one that many of you are very interested in. I just wanted to give you guys a moment, an opportunity. If you don't have a phone, does anyone, or just want to ask a question face to face, and I'll go back and forth between these questions, but if anyone has a question, we do have volunteers with microphones. So if you raise your hand, and obviously we have a lot of different aspects and a lot of different opinions, so we'll try and keep the question short, that would be great, but question...
Hi. I wish we did have someone there that knew more about the Water Sustainability Act. What I do know about it is, and with reference to Damien, is that the Oil and Gas Commission is going to have authority to prioritize the water usage or water licensing in the north, specifically geared to the oil and gas extraction industry. That was a disappointment. I don't know how that's going to appear when the regulations are put together. And also the other aspect that's disappointing to me was the structure of the water controllers. We'll have three times as many water controllers as we had before, but they're still appointments. There's not a, and some of the water controllers are very politically connected.
So do you have a question maybe for Damien?
Well, with regards to, I just would concur with that particular concern you raised about the regulation and the priority of water allocation. And also, I mean, there's been some movement to put some pricing on it, which was completely free before, but it's pretty tiny compared to the kind of volumes of water that we're talking about. Mm-hmm. There's been some movement to finally regulate at all surface water. Surface water and groundwater is kind of funny here because these guys will go and dig a pit knowing that it's going to fill up with water. Where's that water coming from? We don't know. It just fills up in the pit. Maybe it's rain or whatever. But and that becomes surface water. And then it was completely unregulated. Wild Wild West, not even really documented heretofore. And there seems to be some movement to change that a little bit. But and the licensing regime. They're moving to more of a longer term license instead of these Section 8 temporary permits that just keep getting flipped over every year that they need it. But to Olga's point, you know, the prioritization of that water in a region that has been subject to drought conditions for most of the last decade, the Peace Valley,
We're starting to see some real issues around agriculture and the competition for, and you see where farmers can actually make more money now providing access to a pipeline and getting some compensation than they can from farming. Well, that may be the most logical decision for them to make for their family in that moment, but in the long term, that's kind of counterproductive in terms of our food security, I think.
Now, sorry, just continuing on the idea of drought changing things in the future, with California and BC this summer, are these signs of our future West Coast? And this is a question a lot of people wanted to know. Worse yet, will we see migration of large populations to other parts of the country because of this drought? So basically, is California and BC this summer a sign of things to come for the West Coast?
Yeah, I think so. And the forest fires.
Somebody in the United States has done a calibration of the increase in forest fires according to the increase in the mean average temperature. And as the mean average temperature has gone up, the number of forest fires has also gone up. So I don't imagine that we are immune from that either. So, my answer would be, I think it will be, except for the years when we're drowning, because as somebody said, when you've got a drought propensity, you've also got a propensity for deluges, and there'll be some summers with deluges. I don't think we'll see migration.
Simon, got to ask you about this one.
This winter was, I would say, a preview of the future, for sure, but what specifically caused the weather this winter was sort of unique. There was this just atmospheric phenomenon out in the Pacific that caused the water to warm up in this one real spot. Everyone was calling it the blob.
The blob.
You know, scientists are confused when they call something the blob. No, this is blob, right? So, and that's really what drove the drought here. And so it was sort of like the atmosphere caused this in the ocean, and that kind of drove the drought. And that was unusual, but, so 100 years from now, I can't say that's going to happen every winter, but the general effect we had of more rain, what rain did fall, falling as snow, not as much rain falling, all those things, that's exactly what all the climate models say. I wouldn't necessarily expect the winters to be as dry, but they don't have to be as dry for the water impact to be as significant, because our drought this summer was caused by the fact there wasn't a lot of snow in the mountains, right? And so that the water levels in the rivers peaked early, and of course the water levels in the soil basically also peak early. I mentioned that before. So really was a preview of the future. I agree with Maggie that I don't think we have to worry about migrations necessarily as a result of this, because we will, we do have the capacity to adapt to a lot of these things. I think the people you have to worry about are those that are less fortunate. I think you have to worry about First Nations communities, But this was a good preview of the future.
Yeah, as you said, it was possibly a practice. I mean, do you see more Vancouver water restrictions happening in the future then to connect it to this?
I would think so. Yeah. I definitely would expect more water restrictions like this in the future. It doesn't mean it's going to happen next year or even it might not happen again for another 6 or 7 years, but this is what we expect to see. And again, it is true that the water restrictions were not absolutely vital. So I think there's some psychology to putting them into effect.
I mean, if people stop using so much water, don't turn their tap on and then go looking for a glass, or turn their shower on and go looking for a bath towel, and turn their tap on and brush their teeth and, finally turn it off only when it's all finished. All these things add up.
Do you guys think there's a future for the lawn in
That's a great
Vancouver?
Are we going the way of California?
Yeah.
I don't think we're into zero-thermic agriculture yet. But the Okanagan should be. I mean, why are there lawns in the Okanagan? You can grow grapes with that water.
The only thing I'd add to that, I'm concerned about lawns in the future as well, but I would add, just it's important to remember that the, local water use in the cities, you watering your lawn, is tiny compared to how much water is used for agriculture in Canada. And that's by far, it's like 70%,
75%. That's most contexts, that's the case. So most contexts, it's on the order between 60 to 80% is agriculture. I mean, so the agriculture and energy are the big issues.
Yeah.
And energy is also particularly important with respect to the quality considerations.
But of domestic use, there's two uses that are absolutely predominant. One is flushing your toilet, and the other is watering your lawn. And both of these are highly changeable. Nobody ever died of an unflushed toilet or not having a lawn. Both of these habits could change.
And it's interesting.
People have died from unflushed toilets.
That one maybe.
No, people have died from not having toilets at all.
Right.
Yes.
my vegan friend asked me to mention tonight the statistic that he provided me with, and our experts can confirm if this is true or not, but something like a third of all the water use in the world goes to dairy and meat production. Is that track with you guys?
It's believable.
Statistics?
Yeah.
So, I'm not a vegan though. So, but you know, it's interesting these sorts of, and that people would are starting to make food choices based on these things too. It filters down to your home and to a lot of personal decisions, and we may come into a point where people question their food consumption and the types of things they eat based on these larger trends and, you know, the climate. Yeah.
So this is going back to the point that I started with. It's about decisions that we make, but actually a lot of the decisions we make that influence water, affect access to water, are not about water. So it's precisely what you're saying, what we're growing for food crops, you know, where certain crops are grown. So the geography of that, these are all not water policies. They're not water regulations, but that's really what gives us the considerations and the problems that we have with respect to storage and access. So that's one of the things that's so complex from a policy or governance perspective, is that when you're talking about water, you're talking about energy, you're talking about food, you're talking about all these other dimensions, and it's very difficult to have an integrated approach where you're thinking about water and also making decisions in these other sectors, because they tend to be different agencies, they tend to be different factors. And I also want to go back, I'm never going to disagree with Maggie, because I think I'm slightly too wise for that, but I think
I do lots of times.
But I also just want to say, you know, we often do focus on the domestic use, and that is one of the ways in which we can change and we can feel like we're making a difference. But when California went to their mandatory restrictions this past summer, you know, that was only in the domestic sector, which again, it's 20% of domestic water there. And so a lot of the big players, which in that context would be agriculture, which was exempt for, you know, economic and other reasons, political reasons, but also because you have whole food production networks that are based on certain production happening. So these things are not easily changeable overnight. They're not flexible to pick up and change where you grow food and what you grow where. But to the extent that we can move towards more flexibility in the adaptive sense that Simon keeps pointing to, we'll probably be able to make better, bigger choices, you know, and also to recognize that so many of the things are, you know, related to our meat-centered diet and the types of crops and things that we expect when we go to the grocery store.
It's interesting, this concept of drought shaming, which has been so big in California. People with green lawns, they get outed, and it sort of happened here in Vancouver this summer. You know, people call in to say that this lawn was greener than others, so they weren't following the restrictions. It'll be interesting in the future to see if people, you know, turn an eye if you're eating a giant burger or grapes that are grown in California. It might be coming. Okay, I'm going to turn it back to you guys. Question over there.
Thanks. James Casey, WWF Canada. Comment and a question. First comment, Water Sustainability Act regulation development is still alive. There's still regulations being developed. Groundwater is still under discussion. The environmental flow regulation policy is still under discussion. The critical environmental flow, water sustainability planning. All of that is an opportunity for the audience to engage. Question, soon to be live, is the provincial cumulative effects management policy. And I'm wondering if the panel has any recommendations for the audience and what they should be looking for in that policy as it relates to watershed protection.
Sorry, what policy was that? The
cumulative effects.
The provincial cumulative effects management policy.
Cumulative effects management policy.
So James, why don't you give us your opinion, because I have a feeling you are more familiar.
Right, so the province is currently conducting cumulative effect assessments on watershed values and other natural resource values throughout the province, and they are developing a risk-based framework for considering cumulative effects in decision-making. Cumulative effects includes all resource sector activities that occurring on the land base in the northeast, things like LNG development or fracking in this lower part of the province, things like agriculture. Obviously, as you've already mentioned, managed by different agencies. So I'm curious if you have any recommendations about what the audience should be thinking about in their engagement with the policies that are being put forth under cumulative effects.
You've put your finger on another place where we don't think about it. It's like groundwater. We don't think about a watershed, the fact that the water starts coming from high up in a hill and comes down and there's valleys, and whether if somebody logs a forest, it's going to have a change down at the bottom in terms of the quality of the water and the quantity of water that comes down. It's going to change the risk factor for fires, for all of these things. You know, we really don't think about the dynamics of watersheds. We're starting to, but you're putting your finger on this very well, that, how you then manage it is a very interesting question once you've worked through a little bit about these relationships.
I thought it was very interesting that the head of the Joint Review Panel, since retired, that looked into Site C Dam officially, Harry Swain, actually, that was one of his primary recommendations in the report, is that not only should this project be looked at on that level, but the Canadian Environmental Assessment Act should reflect that all future environmental assessments for large projects like that should be looking at it from that big picture perspective. And the Peace Valley is a perfect example of that, with research by the David Suzuki Foundation using satellite imagery and aerial photography going back to the last 50 years, you see that 67% of that valley has been heavily industrialized, and in many cases that's layer upon layer. So you might have had conventional gas in the past and now it's being fracked. You've had roads, logging, mining, hydroelectric corridors, power lines, dams, etc. And it just gets built up and built up. Now every time we look at a single proposal for a well pad for fracking or a new dam or a new mine, which there are many on the books right now and being approved as we speak, none of those are being evaluated from that cumulative perspective. And this is one of our most important watersheds in BC. So it would be great to have that outlook both provincially and federally when it comes to regulation and reviewing projects going forward.
Yeah. Advertisement. The Canadian Water Network just published today a handbook on fracking and the questions that you need to know when you're looking at a fracking project. And obviously, it's all you do is look up CWN and you'll find it. And one of their big messages is that one watershed is not another watershed, and that therefore, you know, it needs to be a very flexible framework to look at the watershed dynamics. But you need to do it and find out what the effects are. So. It was published today, so. Mm-hmm.
Let's take another question from the audience.
My name is Megan Matheson, and I wanted to ask for your thoughts on how our relationship with the United States might change in the future in the context of water, particularly with the Columbia River Basin Treaty needing to be renegotiated, and California produces a lot of the food that we eat here. So we're eating California's water to a certain extent, so maybe they'd want some of it back. And how would we deal with that, especially considering NAFTA and other treaties that govern our relationship so far?
Very interesting.
Wow. Who wants
to question. Yeah, who wants to start with this one?
Yeah. As we
I
all
don't,
look left.
I don't, really. Someone else can say something.
So Simon.
It is a terrific question, and I think it's, you know, I think everyone here is hesitating to answer because it's hard to predict exactly what will happen. But with the idea that, you know, we are eating a lot of California's water because we import so much of our produce from California, it's important to keep in mind how much water we export, right? And there's, you know, there's a little bit of a blow up politically earlier about one candidate saying something about bulk water exports 10 years ago. The idea of bulk exports of water to the U.S. is what seems to scare the crap out of everybody, right? But we should keep in mind that, and again, I'm not defending the idea of, you know, scooping out of the water out of Harrison Lake and sending it across the border or something, but that we export water all the time. We just export it in the form of grain and oil, basically, and other commodities, right? And so I've actually worked it out this morning. So this, on average, exports of oil were around 100, with each barrel of oil, particularly bitumen, taking about 2 to 3 barrels of water. We're exporting about 150 billion liters of water a year, right? So it's like 150 billion of these, although I have no idea if that's a liter. So the idea that the U.S. could block, you know, exports of something from California to us,
is unlikely because of how many things they're importing from us that rely on our water. Like, so we're kind of in a mutual, you know, more mutually assured destruction, I would say, than anything else.
Yeah, Australia kept exporting wheat to China during the big Australian drought. Why did they do this? Because they have wheat farmers. And the wheat farmers needed to maintain their sales. And so therefore they decided that this was a legitimate use. But Australia was exporting water to China in the middle of the worst drought that Australia's had for 7 years. It was a very deliberate decision to keep on growing wheat because you've got your whole wheat sector. And what are you going to do if the wheat sector, is not employed? So it's a decision. I don't think the Americans are going to come north of the border with forced pipelines and convoys of trucks. First of all, it's not a very economical way to carry water around. Secondly, they've got two big rivers, the Klamath and the Columbia, between us and California. If I were going to take water at the mouth of a river, I'd certainly investigate the Klamath or the Columbia first. I mean, if you can imagine going 100 miles inland or 10 miles inland and taking 10% of the flow that would otherwise get to the ocean, they've got nobody to ask except themselves. As Columbia River Partners, we have nothing to say about how much of the Columbia River they actually let go into the ocean. So that is within their own purview. So why would they come up here and get difficult water that needs to be pipelined down? When Barcelona was having its big drought, the mayor insisted that they do something real and dramatic and visible. So they had a water tanker go to France, and it filled up the water, and then it came and dumped it in the Barcelona reservoirs. It lasted 12 minutes. So you can't carry around enough water to make a significant difference, and that was drinking water, not. As Leila points out, not the big act, which is agricultural water. So, and the other thing is that, you know, desal, when people think about desalination, how many desal plants do you think there are in the world?
Someone said 150. 250.
250?
Several thousand was another answer.
17,000. And the United States has 2,000 of them, and some of them are over $1 billion each. The big ones that they're putting in down in Tampa and that are going in Florida, these are big monsters. And they're building to oversupply. They're building over capacity so that they are prepared for the eventuality of the very dry summers. And these are really big plants. And they're also putting some of their used water, nice word for sewage, treated sewage into the aquifer so that they've already got a supply of that they can also clean. So, they're doing a lot of innovative things, and they're moving out of some water-intensive crops. So between desal changing crops, they are reducing their per capita, their per-person water use every day. We are not. We're still right up with Dubai, number one and number two, with the amount of water that we use per person in Canada, which doesn't exactly make us a role model when the rest of the world is coming to try and get good examples on how to cut down on water use. So, the United States, I haven't seen lineups of people sort of heading north across the border saying, we're going to get your water. The main people who think that's going to be the case are Canadians, not Americans.
I'd just like to add one thing, since trade agreements are in the news again. We take some risks with NAFTA when we start, and I've seen this with electricity. It's right places like the Abitibi Bowater plant that was designed to power and take water to power a mill became owned by an American company, and our government went over Danny Williams' head when he was premier. Mm-hmm. They went bankrupt, and instead should have relinquished that to the government free of cost. But they were threatened to sue us at the NAFTA tribunal. The premier at the time, Danny Williams, said basically take a hike, and he was willing to do a showdown with them. And Stephen Harper went over his head and cut a check for, I think it was $250 million of compensation. And I was very concerned with the private river power program in BC. These are these quote unquote IPPs, that's an innocuous name, but it's private. And we obtained an organization I was involved with obtained an opinion from Wendy Holm, the agrologist, former president of the BC Agrologist Association, and expert on NAFTA issues as they relate to food and energy.
And she warned that the way that these licenses were being given out, once they're issued, and this is to potentially to an American company to control a river, to divert it for power production, that we would potentially lose control of the term, whether it runs 20 years or 40 years. Once it's out, we'd be compelled to renew that indefinitely or compensate under Chapter 11, which could be billions of dollars out of your pockets. And that we couldn't necessarily guarantee that we can control the use. So even though it might be issued for one purpose, like power production, then it couldn't be converted or diverted to a different purpose. So we have to be very careful with these trade agreements in place, and particularly in NAFTA, apropos your question, when we start handing away rights to our water and our energy to those trading partners. And that those issues may become more and more relevant in an era of changing climate and energy conditions and scarcity.
Would it be the same if a Canadian had bought those rights?
Well, presumably, but we're the most sued country under any trade regime in the world. We've had 10 times as much more as many threats of litigation or actual NAFTA cases compared with the United States. We're 10 times.
Well, there's only three countries in NAFTA.
We're 10 times.
So any corporation, though, can go to the tribunal. It's not country to country.
It's not country, they're corporations.
It's any corporation. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So there's
a lot more U.S. corporations.
There are a lot more U.S. corporations, but we're a tenth the size of a country, but we've been sued 10 times as many times. Mm-hmm. So we see a lot more litigation around this agreement than our trading partners do. And we start to make decisions on that basis just out of the fear of that or the threat of it. We start cutting checks, and that it's a risk.
I'm going to have to cut off the question portion for now. I have a feeling we could talk till the early hours. But we won't keep going. We'll let you swarm the panelists during the reception part of the evening. But I do want to give you one more chance. We've got about 4 minutes left before I pass it back over to Jeff to ask you one final question. I mean, it's clearly an important issue that we're all passionate about. And I'd love to show you the rest of the questions from the audience afterwards. Just great, great topics. If you were making the rules, what would be the first step to improving water quality and quantity? Leila, why don't we start with you?
Okay.
60 seconds.
Yeah, I was just going to make 2 points on this. One is fuller recognition that water is a social good. So much like education, we're actually all better off when everybody has safe and affordable access. So it's not something where one person is better if other people don't have it. It's actually if everybody has access, everybody's better off. So I think stronger recognition of that and how it plays out in our priorities and funding would be really important. The other thing that I want to emphasize is I often talk a lot about drinking water, and that's because I'm concerned about basic questions of access and equity and so forth. But one of the things that I find most important and most compelling is to really have a much broader perspective about water. And, you know, a lot of people are arguing this when they talk about human right to water. A lot of First Nations make this point over and over that it's not just about drinking water. We need water for livelihoods. We need source water. We need water for fish. So anything that we can do conceptually to think about water in a much more holistic and inclusive way, I think is really important. This has come home for us very strongly in recent work we've been doing around microbial risk and microbial issues. And the truth of the matter is we often treat water in a very technical way, in a very narrow way. You know, we're going to treat it, we're going to kill the microbes, and we're going to have safe drinking water. But we need to be moving in a much more holistic way, thinking about source water protection, thinking about the microbes in the water, and that might be important for us as well, rather than wanting to treat water, you know, and kill all the microbes. So I think we need to move in our policy, but also our general thinking towards a more inclusive appreciation about water issues.
Damien?
I'd probably start by undoing everything that we did over the last 5 years in this country in terms of gutting all the important federal regulations that we have. That would just scratch it. That wasn't even good enough to begin with, but we should start with that, getting back to where we were at least. I think that we need to absolutely be thinking of water as a human right, and it is disgraceful and completely morally bankrupt and unacceptable in this country that we have such a disproportionate lack of access to healthy water and quality water for our First Nations communities in this country, many of whom are in that position because
of industry that we've talked about here tonight that is again an example of kind of coming and taking from that territory, taking from the north, from rural communities, not being too concerned about what the long-term consequences are of that, and then leaving behind a mess. And so I think that is something that we absolutely, is a high moral imperative for Canada. We're number six in the world in quality of life. If you took First Nations out as a group, we're 63rd. So we'd be below a lot of developing nations. That's just unacceptable. That has to change. And water, I think water is a very much a parallel or a subset or a microcosm of that. And finally, I think we have so much, you know, there was a hydrologist from France that we interviewed for my film, our film Fractured Land, and he made the point that France has been studying and understands this aquifer so well, this goes back centuries, they know it's there, and that probably had a big impact on the fact that France banned fracking and Canada hasn't, because we're such a young country and we have such a juvenile approach to understanding our groundwater and our aquifers. That's something that we need to change and put real science-based decision making in place with real teeth to enforce it.
Simon?
That was fantastic. Following a little bit on what Damien said, especially earlier about the energy industry, so much of the conflicts we're having over water in this country are related to the fact that we use a lot of our water to produce fossil fuels. And you could get at a lot of the water issues in this country by actually addressing the fact that we're creating a lot of fossil fuels. And that's why I think it goes to, you know, if not just putting back in place all the regulations that have been cut and changed over the past 5 years, but actually looking federally at some sort of thing similar to what British Columbia has, like a price on carbon. It's probably going to be dictated by what Alberta decides in the next few months. But that could go a long way to indirectly solving a lot of the water issues in the country. The other thing I just want to point to is the other thing that's changed in the past few years was what our relationship is with the rest of the world, and particularly with respect to international aid. If you want to help the world deal with climate change, most of those threats are making sure people are going to have fresh water available, whether for agriculture or for personal use, given the fact that their baseline, like ours, is changing because the climate is changing. And we can do that. We have international promises we're supposed to be meeting about how much money we're providing, either through aid or through loans and whatnot. And Canada's really fallen down on that. It doesn't get a lot of press, but a small move in that direction could help the rest of the world a lot.
Final word. Well, I want everything they want.
Yeah,
so
me too.
Okay, so I want everything there. And I can't think of very much icing to put on those particular three layers of the cake. I would like a national water dialogue, not necessarily a federal one, but a national water dialogue that really sets out some of the parameters of where water is going. Alberta tried to make that happen a couple of years ago. They did some quite good studies in Alberta water situation. Much more complex than ours. Got many, many climatic zones and many, many uses, and they've got a big irrigated sector in the south, and they've got the big rivers, so it's a very different situation. But they thought that they needed a really good national dialogue to get things going and to start talking about water the way we talk about energy, or we should be talking more about energy. And I guess the other thing I'd have is true water education for little kids. So that they would start not thinking about water as something that if it's dirty you just add chlorine. You know, start asking yourself where water comes from. You know, like where does milk come from? The supermarket. You know, well, where does water come from? The bottle. So we really need to try and stop that and try and turn it around a little bit.
I told you they'd be good.
Yeah.
I wish we could keep going. I think your suggestion of a federal water dialogues discussion, U4 would be top of the list. I'm sure, like myself, many of you are left with even more questions perhaps than you came with, but I think that's a good place to be. So thank you so much for your thoughts and openness, and I'm sure there'll be a swarm after we leave here today. But at this time, I'll turn it back over to Jeff, and one more round of applause. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Johanna, for doing such a great job as our moderator this evening. So thank you.
No one fell out of the
And I have to say, you all did very well with the technology. There are a lot of questions there, so there were a lot unanswered. So there will be an opportunity here shortly to engage with our panelists and one another further on this topic. So we want to simply encourage all of you to stay connected with your alma mater wherever you are. There's some easy ways to do this, like reading Trek Magazine and Trek Online, and going online to learn of many alumni services and initiatives. There's also a couple of things coming up in the calendar that we just want to mention. On October 15th is our 98th annual UBC Alumni Association AGM at the Robert H. Lee Alumni Center. We also, on October 27th, also at the Robert H. Lee Alumni Center, the 2015 Alumni Achievement Awards. And on October 28th, we're going to have a Your Next Step program, Crossing Borders, at the Robert H. Lee Alumni Center. And this one's going to be in partnership with the U.S. Consul General. And you're going to be able to hear from experts on how to navigate the process of working in the United States. So finally, who has your A card? How many of you have A cards? A fair number. That's great. Well, if you've not signed up for a free A card, you can see Dayan at the back of the room in the hallway, and he'll certainly sign you up. But the A card really gives you great access to discounts from a variety of partners. And one of the great benefits is the access to the library journals and other resources. So take advantage of that and get yours today. Now, I'd like to announce we also have a prize this evening from the business cards that were entered at the registration. So I am without my glasses, so I'm going to say I may very well butcher this name. Is Piotr Karase here? Did I say that correctly? No? All right. Then I've got another one. I've come prepared. Laura Mervin? Laura, are you still here? All right. Laura, I have something up here at the front that I'll give you afterwards, all right? So we're, again, thanks to our panel, and we want to once again want to thank Scotiabank and the CBC and the Irving K. Barber Learning Center, and thanks again to all of you for joining us, and now we invite you to join us for a reception in the hallway. Thank you.